David, thank you so much for the invitation to be here and to all of you for making time. It seems extraordinary that we're gathered in this place on a Tuesday night in person to have this conversation. Thank you for making time to be here and for the opportunity to be in this particular house on this topic. Some of you may know that in his prior role, President Oxtoby was the president of Pomona College, which has a vanishingly small admission rate right now for students trying to get there, and lots of popularity from Andover to try to come to Pomona. But he is no stranger to this very topic. In fact, on many occasions, he navigated a very successful way, I think, through these conversations at Pomona in ways that I much admire. So thank you for that inspiration. In particular, one that happened in 2017 involved an Andover graduate, a woman named Heather McDonald, a conservative writer who came to Pomona, and you had to figure out a way through that situation, which I hope maybe later tonight you would talk about, because that's a great, great case study on this topic. I'm thrilled to be here, in particular, at this house of the American Academy, in part because of the founding values of this institution and how directly they tie to this topic that we will take up tonight. This is a little hard to see, but it's the charter, you can imagine, of this very institution. You may know that at around the time of its founding, there was a charter created by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts that created the institution, and it laid out many of the things that David Oxtoby noted. And from the very start, the idea of the American Academy was to foster the debate of precisely the sort that we're having tonight. And in many ways, I think this topic is as old as our country and deeply newfangled at the same time. It ties up lots of ideas that are very much of this moment, but it also harkens back to the founding values of this country and the founding tensions in our documents that really set up the nation. The idea, in a nutshell, of liberty on the one hand, which I think traces to today's debate around free expression, and equality on the other, which traces to our commitment these days to diversity, equity, and inclusion, are things that are in the founding values of the country and in this very document founding this institution, and they've always been in tension, and they are very much in tension today. I believe we can resolve that tension in positive ways, and in fact, great institutions and great democracies do that, and where we fail to do so, I think we come out in a much less good place. And this particular institution, through events like this, but also through publications such as Daedalus, have taken up this issue over and over again. There's an amazing history when you read back through copies of Daedalus of exactly this conversation at different moments. I thought of you, Dean Minow, on this last one. But the topic of how we imagine a world in which we have both liberty and equality in not just equal measure, but together in the context of both education and in our civic sphere strikes me as one of the hardest problems for our country to face, and yet one of the most important that we resolve. I will hit in the next 25 minutes or so a series of flashpoints which I think evoke the moment and which I think play this out. These are some of them. There are many other ways in to the story, but I will hit each of them just with an example, and then I hope maybe in conversation we'll play some of those out, and then I hope very much in discussion we will argue about them. But some of the backdrop I think that is incredibly important begins with really large-scale demographic trends, which is to say, depending on who you ask, most likely by 2055, the United States will be a majority-minority country. There are many ways to describe this, but the point being that we are becoming a more diverse nation. I take that to be a wonderful thing, and it really does change in many respects the way in which young people who are coming into our universities are thinking about their community. And college campuses themselves, much as a school like Andover, are increasingly diverse. So at Andover, a school that was founded around the same time as this institution in 1778, so it beat you by 2 years, President Oxtoby, it started with 13 white boys, one of whom turns out to have come from outside the country, but it is today 1,100 students, about half of whom are white, half of whom are students of color, many of whom actually are mixed race, which has been a growing a trend at our school, but similar things have happened on our university campuses. Some of these numbers are particularly striking, certainly looking at the growth in Asian American students from about 0.5% to 10% growing toward 2015. I would imagine that continues. Certainly the two or more races and ethnicities, the fact that students self-identify as mixed race, that has grown enormously. I'd say at Andover that continues also to be a very large area of growth. Certainly the Latino, Latinx population having similar growth. One thing to note is the African-American number, which goes from 7% up to 10% and then down to 8.5%. I think that's an extraordinary thing, which I had not focused on before seeing this particular slide. At the same time, of course, over time, it is the case that our campuses are increasingly diverse, also a wonderful thing, an important thing. And these debates obviously play out across the headlines. We can come back to the lawsuit at Harvard as one example if you wish, but I think it is a sign of some of the challenges that those who are applying to schools and those who are thinking of our universities as sites of political action have been arguing. There are many ways to describe this particular lawsuit, but I think for sure on one level it is an assault on the affirmative action that has created some of those numbers that we saw momentarily ago. And at the same time, there are many complicated cross currents. And I think in some ways it is those cross currents that we talk about tonight in the context of Harvard and the way in which it has become more inclusive during this period as well as more diverse. There have been people who have thought that the university has not been getting it quite right. And there are calls in some respects to change the policy, change the direction in this particular case to ensure that students do have the ability to come together in single sex clubs as one example, and which we again can come back to. Let me start, though, with the idea of safe spaces. I think this may be the one that is most familiar to you because it's been probably most in the press. And I passed out, if you're interested, a copy of this letter. You might be able to see it up here. I think it's one of the best case studies in this topic because it really grabbed the attention of many people when it came out a few years ago. You probably have had this experience of either being a parent or being a student yourself and getting that letter from the dean welcoming you to the school year. And having been somebody who writes them, they're very boring to write, and they're even worse to read. But this one actually grabbed a lot of attention, and it made these letters much more interesting, at least for a while. And I think it'd be fun to think about whether you thought this was a good idea or not. But it was a shot across the bow by the University of Chicago against many of these trends that I think we have been seeing in terms of campus speech and how it's been changing over time. So very specifically, The third paragraph says, our commitment to academic freedom means that we do not support so-called trigger warnings, we'll take up in a minute. We do not cancel invited speakers because their topics might prove controversial, and we do not condone the creation of intellectual safe spaces where individuals can retreat from ideas and perspectives at odds with their own. And so this created a debate among those of us who run schools about whether this is the right message to send to an increasingly diverse group of students who are arriving on a campus. And you can imagine the debate that ensued. Some saying this is precisely what we need. This is exactly the pushback against a series of overreaches by the left seeking to force a version of diversity, equity, and inclusion on these communities, and in fact, to stand up for robust debate. Others said this is the most unwelcoming thing you could have sent, and particularly if you come from an underrepresented minority group or a marginalized member of a community, saying that there should not be such types of safe spaces was exactly what you don't want to hear as you walk onto a campus. And one of the reasons this caused a particular kerfluffle is that this particular dean who wrote it, Jay Ellison, was in fact an advisor to a safe space on the Chicago campus, which was the LGBTQ space that had been created and literally called itself the safe space for that group of students. I will gladly put this on the table for later debate. In the book, I make an argument that, in fact, we need to have some safe spaces on our campuses, just as we need to have brave spaces on our campuses. And I actually think the LGBTQ community that is created on many of our campuses is precisely the type of safe space that we would have and where it's important to do that. I think, likewise, a Hillel on a campus where you might say there are particular rules, there are particular speech rules that suggest that you should not have hate speech of a certain sort. You couldn't have a member of, I don't know, the KKK walk into a hate space, a space like a Hillel and to speak certain things in that environment. It strikes me those are reasonable rules that you might set up for a safe space. Likewise, you might have a different set of rules in other places within a university. Those might be determined to be brave spaces, environments in which students would be expected to be exposed to things that would make them uncomfortable. Again, we can come back to that trade-off, but I would make the case that we actually need safe spaces for our communities, just as we need brave spaces. Second example is trigger warnings. So for those who are not familiar with this, the idea is that before walking into a class, say, or a lecture, the expectation would be that somebody might give you a warning that you might be triggered in a particular way. So a classic example would be an English class. If you were told before you opened a book that there might be some violent rape scenes, as an example, that appear in the book, particularly if you as a teacher knew that one of the members of the class had experienced sexual assault at some point in their life, you might say that this is a reasonable way to trigger, to warn somebody that they may be triggered by something they were about to read. Likewise, you might say if you were in before you were to show a particularly graphic movie, you might offer a warning to a student before that happened. Of course, the reaction to that has not been universally positive. There have been a number of articles, in fact, a book on this topic called The Coddling of the American Mind, making the case that this is precisely what we should not do. That, in fact, the idea that there should be somebody standing up and warning you about what you're going to experience, rather than having people experience it and then debate it afterwards, is the downfall of our civilization, or maybe in a slightly simpler form of it, in fact, it is undercutting the academic integrity of our institutions. I think particularly trigger warnings have been a topic because they suggest that they might be a cramp on intellectual freedom. So think about what a trigger warning is. If you are requiring somebody to say something, are you in fact undercutting the academic freedom that a teacher has in their classroom? Again, all of these things we can come back to as examples. The way that I've treated it at the school at Andover is I actually believe that trigger warnings are simply good manners if they're used in an appropriate way, that I as a teacher might use them in a particular setting if I'm worried about a particular student or a group of students and the experience they're about to have. At the same time, I don't think it's a good idea to mandate them. I can't imagine telling a teacher you must use trigger warnings in a particular way or to require that across an institution. And institutions have done all of the above. There have been requirements around trigger warnings. There have been a middle ground, like the one I'm suggesting. And there have been statements, such as the University of Chicago's, which suggests that you shouldn't have trigger warnings and students shouldn't expect trigger warnings. I think a helpful debate. Third example, microaggressions. This might be one that requires, in some cases, a little more explanation or definition, but you may be familiar with it. On our campuses, particularly as they've become more diverse, I hear a lot from students and from faculty that at different points there are slights which are expressed toward them in ways that are difficult to handle within the context of an academic community. A microaggression might be something that is stated and which might not have been experienced by some people in one way, but would be experienced by others in another way. An example that is often used is the example when President Obama was described as being articulate. And the experience that then an African-American student, or the president in this particular case, might say, that is something that is experienced differently by an African-American than by a white speaker. Why? Because there's a presumption in history that black people are not as articulate as white people, and that while that might have been a perfectly well-meaning statement, the intent to that might have been, oh, I was simply saying the president is well-spoken, it's received. The impact of that is quite different. That could be an example of a microaggression. Now, it may not be the best example because the president of the United States has a great deal of power. You can imagine somebody walking into a university setting or a school where there's much less power in that person. Importantly, what students will tell you is that this is wrapped up also in the concept of intersectionality, the notion that when somebody walks into an environment like a historically white and historically male institution, and in a number of different ways, that student feels and experiences the environment as being a marginalizing space, it may be that they experience these microaggressions along multiple dimensions. And so when you think about the way in which we lead our institutions and we care about students, as we have a more and more diverse set of students appearing, they also experience the education that they have in very different ways. So likewise, this becomes a very complicated thing from a policy perspective, which is to say, do you ban microaggressions as you seek to have a more inclusive and more equitable environment? And there are many examples that I've experienced as an administrator where you have to pull people in who have been in one of these conversations and try to explain the extent to which these words that you might not have intended as being aggressive have had an impact on somebody that's very different than they might have had some time ago. Again, something that we can talk about. I think that for many people who are involved in an example like this, I think it makes them feel like they are a racist because they are being told that they have harmed somebody based on their race, or they might be feel like they're being told they're misogynist because they've said something based on gender that they didn't intend. At the same time, the impact is very real. And for some people, the exhaustion and the effect and the way in which it affects their education is very different than it might have been decades ago when we didn't have the same conversation. And I think in some ways, this, like the other examples, are pitting some of these values that we hold together against one another. Fourth example has to do with speakers and the extent to which speakers are not allowed on our campus. Consistently, I think, over the last several years, debates over whether or not institutions should provide a platform for speakers have been one of the most challenging of the topics. Harvard has plenty of examples of this. Harvard speakers, when they go elsewhere, have been examples of the same topic. I'll give a few examples here that have been, I think, most played out on the public stage. Certainly the arrival of Charles Murray, who had been invited by actually relatively left-leaning faculty member at Middlebury, sought to present the work. They had a plan to have sort of a debate-type format. It led to an altercation, physical altercation outside of the space, and it led to a national debate, I think, over whether or not a conservative speaker could, in fact, give a talk about a work, which turned out not to be the work that was necessarily the one under debate, on a liberal arts campus in the United States. I think this is very close, maybe, to the Heather McDonald example that I hope President Oxtoby might talk about later. Milo Yiannopoulos has been, I think, in some ways the most difficult case for many of the universities that have been grappling with this issue. He is a provocateur whose purpose, I think, in many respects, is to cause a problem by coming to the campus and to raise many of these issues. He has a lot of topics on which he is, let's say, controversial, if not obnoxious. The challenge, I think, for the university administrators who have had him visit is, on the one hand, particularly on a state campus, if you are bound by the First Amendment, which you are, and you have somebody whose speech is so challenging, you want to afford them the space in which to give give this kind of a lecture. At the same time, it ends up costing you between $500,000 and $1 million in the security to allow for the speech to happen. I think there's a very hard and interesting question buried here, which is there a requirement, in essence, for a university to have somebody who many of the members of the community do not wish to hear speak come to the campus if they're invited by some members of the community, and then to allocate $500,000 or $1 million, whether that is state money or that's tuition dollars or that's from the endowment, that becomes, for me as an administrator, a very tricky question, even as I have a very strong impulse to support the First Amendment rights of those both to hear and to speak on university campuses. I think the Chelsea Manning example here at the Kennedy School is a very good and tricky example of this, where fellowship had been at least offered, I believe, and then pulled back after ostensibly some pressure on the Kennedy School, potentially from government sources. I'm not sure all of the facts because I was not involved, but certainly read the coverage of it. I think the one that seems to me the least sympathetic was the idea that Christine Lagarde was invited to Smith College and then uninvited on the grounds that she represented capitalism or something of that sort. And not to belittle the critique, that one didn't seem to be as substantive perhaps as others. But the examples go on and on. There are many that I think we could take up and think through. Is it important, in fact, that speakers who have these particular controversial views be able to provide the provocation that they seek on a university campus? I think, in general, the answer, of course, is yes. We certainly support that on the state university campuses, in part because the First Amendment requires it. It's a little bit trickier for those of us who lead private institutions, and we can talk about why we might think about that differently as well. What's interesting is I think there's an assumption that students are not supportive of having provocative speakers on their campuses, in part because the examples, such as Heather McDonald at Pomona or Charles Murray at Middlebury. This is data that comes from an organization called FIRE, which does a lot of work in this area, and which, by the way, has a very strong free speech orientation. But they found even fire, which I think is often critical of students in this way, found that 93% of students agree that schools should have a variety of guest speakers on campus. I have found in my own environment at Andover that many of our faculty are less eager to have a wide range of perspectives represented among speakers. But students actually often come in my office and say, we need a wider range, which I think is very positive. The less sort of awesome number, I think, is the one on the top right. This idea that there might be times when a college or university should withdraw the guest speaker's invitation after it's been announced. I find that tricky, but there might in fact be such instances. But relatively few students feel that it's appropriate to disrupt a speaker when they come, although certainly when they do, it makes headlines. Final example is the renaming of spaces and of symbols on our campuses. I think one of the ways in which this topic plays out most visibly is the fact that we certainly have, in a campus like Harvard's or a campus like Andover's, virtually all of the campus symbols represent white men for a variety of reasons, in part because of the leadership on these campuses, in part because who has been donors, those we have honored. And sometimes that proves complicated, particularly in this diverse, equitable, and inclusive environment we find ourselves. The best example, I think, that is local, and I will highlight Martha Minow's role in this, was the debate over Harvard Law School's shield. And if I get anything wrong, I will be corrected, because the author of the story is in the front row. The Harvard Law School, as you may know, was founded as part of the university, but thanks in part to a gift from the family of Isaac Royal. I believe that the Royal family offered Harvard the money for either medicine or law as a chair, and the university chose law. That chair grew into a law school. The chair still exists and is, in fact, used by a member of the faculty. And along the way, although not at the beginning, about 100 years later, the law school adopted the royal family crest as its shield. Is that right, about 100 years after founding? Ballpark? 1936. Okay, so 100 and a bit. However, it turns out that the royal family generated the funds that ended up founding this chair and founding the law school through slavery. So this was a plantation-owning family. They were, in fact, British by birth, but they literally created the funds on the backs of slaves, and it was those funds that then founded this particular school, and it is this family crest that the law school has been using. This necessarily gave rise to a conversation, and I think actually the holder of the chair for many years has given a really wonderful lecture about the royal chair, which I've found a fabulous way to handle being in the royal chair, talking about the family and the background, and there's in fact an amazing image that the Harvard Law School has, a beautiful painting of it that helps to surface this history, and I think that's been very, very healthy. But there was a conversation that said, in fact, should we not be using this shield? And Martha Minow, the dean at the time, did what I think I would like any administrator to have done, which was to try to make it an educational experience, but also to bring the community together around whether or not that shield should, in fact, continue to be used. The committee ended up with a split decision, ultimately. It was a large percentage of the faculty were in, and students who were on the committee decided that the school should in fact come up with a new shield, and there was reasons why that was a good idea to get rid of this particular past. Two members of the committee dissented, one of whom was Annette Gordon-Reed, pictured here, a faculty member and historian and a student, and they wrote a wonderful dissent that went along with this that basically said you shouldn't whitewash this particular history. In fact, leave the shield and keep talking about it and use it as a teaching tool. I believe that the outcome of that was then the decision was sent to the Corporation of Harvard to come up with a new shield. Is there yet a new shield? I don't think there is. But in fact, the decision has been sent to the university. But a great deal of conversation, many community meetings, I think wonderful reports, and a really beautiful monument that was dedicated. This is Drew Faust here along with Professor Gordon Reed in the law school that looks at some of this history and I believe was a great example of how to handle this kind of a dispute. Before I end, I just want to share a few other facts that are out there. I believe that one of the unfortunate aspects of this topic is the way in which the press has been describing this as a generation that hates free speech. Nothing could be further from the truth. And I live with 1,140 students on a high school campus. I can assure you that these data are true. These ones are funded by the Knight Foundation. And we've been doing this study for many years. But high school support for the First Amendment is the highest in the last 10 years. It's been going up, not down, which I think is actually quite important to note. But students do worry about what's happening in our country, and in ways that I think are actually pretty savvy. The concern, these are obviously the freedoms in the First Amendment, the freedom of speech right is thought to be maybe less secure than it was a few years ago. And in fact, in each of these areas, there's a decline. The largest decline in the freedom of the press, I think this also corresponds to a presidency in which there's been an attack on the press. That certainly is sensible in that way. The one that I will note that's particularly interesting as data is the freedom for people to assemble peaceably. This is the one area where there's very significant difference in the data between students who are white and students of color. So students who are white tend to think that there's a stronger right to assemble peaceably. Students of color perceive that there is less strong of such a right and, in fact, that it's going down more quickly. Final data. This is a slide that it's also from Knight Foundation survey on this same topic, and I think ultimately there's a lot of good news in here. The idea that we could hold these ideas of diversity, equity, inclusion, and speech together, but it asks a question that I really hate on the right here, which is more important, diversity and inclusion versus free speech? So I really, even though I'm the chairman of the board of the foundation that funded this study, I really dislike it because it creates a false choice to my mind. You have to choose between these two. However, even though I hate it, I actually found it revealing when I looked at it, because it does, I think, convey some of the political divides that we have in our country, and the extent to which, if made to make this choice, and again, if I were a survey respondent, I would have skipped the question because I find it too hard to suggest, but if you're a Democrat, you are much more likely to say that a diverse and inclusive society is more important, whereas Republicans think quite the different, the opposite. What is so interesting to me about this is that I think that the idea of free speech has changed, or free expression, from one that has been perceived, I think, for many years, in fact, for centuries, as often the zone of the left, to one that is absolutely the purview of the right. And you think about the most important speech in the 19th century around free expression, I think, is Frederick Douglass's speech, A Plea for Free Speech in Boston, an abolitionist saying, we need to have the right to free speech so we can make the case for an end to slavery. You think about the 1960s, the free speech movement at Berkeley was a bunch of radical lefties, right? This was not exactly the right. Today, it's actually quite the opposite. And I think one of the reasons this is so complicated, and I'll end with this concept, is that many of those who are the administrators on campuses who are being pushed so hard by students saying you shouldn't favor speech in these ways as against diversity, equity, and inclusion were those same lefty radical students from the 60s who are holding up their hands saying, wait a minute, I'm the good guy, I believe in these things, this is really important, and yet they are being perceived by students as being out of step with the moment that we are in. I hope very much that we will have a lively discussion tonight. I look forward to engaging with my former dean and boss, Martha Minow, and am eager to hear your questions in a moment. Thank you so much.